board elected to give you guys a little bonus at Christmas time, and that's why we have you up here. But Pastor, we just thank you for all your dedication, what you went through, especially during this year with COVID, giving us great sermons, adopting the online services, doing the extra work, and just shepherding your flock. And we love you for it. Thank you very much. Enjoy that. And Coach Carter, we want to thank you too for leading our youth during this difficult time and coming up with new ways to reach them, being online and going outside even when it's cold and doing stuff. We appreciate it very much. So thank you for all your service.
Will you stand if you're able as we worship our Heavenly Father this morning?
Joy to the world, the Lord is good. Let earth receive a king. Let every that we never could straight from the way. My heart no longer to keep from singing. All that is within me cries for you alone to glorify Emmanuel, God with us. My heart has sing a brand new song. Such a tiny offering compared to Calvary. Nevertheless, we lay it at your feet. Such a tiny offering compared to Calvary. Nevertheless, God with us.
Amen. You may be seated.
Oh, that's a nice Christmas tree. Oh, hey, we're started. I get easily distracted. Do you guys? I definitely do. If you guys have met someone that, or maybe you are yourself, easily distracted, if you haven't met someone like that, my name is Carter. I'm like that. And that is something I've struggled with for the longest time. I don't think I have ADHD or ADD. Never been told I do, but I sure act like I do because you tell me to go this way, I'll be there for like a minute. Then, ooh, hey, what's over here? That's how I've always been. And so today we're talking about letting go of distractions. So that actually was planned, obviously. I didn't actually get distracted, but I would. That would be something I would do. Let's go ahead and get started here. Sweet, it's already there. All right. So before we go into further, will you guys go ahead and pray with me? Dear God, thank you for this day. I pray that you'll just bring peace, that you would open our hearts and we would hear what you have to say, God. And I pray that we would go home and spend time with our families and also apply this to our lives, God. In your name I pray. Amen. All right. So the word distraction comes from the Latin word distrahere, which means to drag or draw away. And John 10:10 says, "But the devil comes to steal, kill, and destroy." One of the things he loves to steal is our attention. He likes to drag it away from God, draw it away from God. For example, let's say God is telling you to be a missionary, but you're like, "Oh, I come from a family of doctors. Everyone told me I'd be a great doctor. Personally, everyone told me I'd be a great teacher. Am I in a classroom right now? I'm not." Actually, I guess I'm a preschool teacher, but that's different. Anyways, but that was a bad example. But anyways, my attention was drawn away, because from a young age, if you would have asked me, or my mom even has a video of it on like Little Mr. Kingston, they asked me what I wanted to be when I grew up. I said a pastor. I had no idea I said that, like up until like a year after I graduated. I always thought I was going to be a teacher. But anyways, the devil, not that being a teacher is bad, don't get me wrong, I love teachers, but that's not my calling. The devil tried to drag away the attention from what God was telling me to do and to go off in a different direction. And thank God I made my way back. So where am I at? So distraction is when you're drawn away from your task or from your focus. So I want you guys to do this with me. Make an estimate of how many times you are distracted during an average work day. Me, I'm going to do a low number and say 10, but I guarantee I'm probably somewhere between 20 and 30. If you take that number and then times it by 25, that's how many minutes you're distracted a day, on average. Because it takes exactly 23 minutes and 15 seconds to return to your original task after an interruption. I have a lot of interruptions. I work with preschoolers. I started cleaning the bathrooms on Thursday. Next thing you know, I'm playing checkers with the preschooler during nap time because they didn't want a nap. I never did finish. Sorry if my boss is watching. I did finish the next day, though. I will say that. But anyways, so for me, let's say 10 times in a day I get distracted. That's 250 minutes. That's 4 hours for all you math teachers. Mr. Winslow, he was my math teacher. But anyways, that's how many minutes of concentration you're losing. And that is a lot of time taken away from what you should be focused on. We have good distractions, I should not refer to them as distractions, but there's things in our life that have priority. Our families, our job, our church family, what we do. And then there's distractions that lead us away from God. All those priorities should not be above God. As Christians, we're called to surrender our lives to God. So if you surrender to someone, I don't see him here, but I'm going to say it anyways. I was playing paintball with some of my teens, and I'm not distracted. This isn't here. But he came up to me, and we have a rule, surrender or die. So he's sitting here like this, from me to Caleb away, and says, "Coach Carter, surrender or die." I dropped it, and I walked away. He shot me anyways. But I surrendered. And I didn't just drop the paintball. No, I dropped a slingshot too. When you surrender to God, you're giving him your all. So if you're putting something above him, there's something you're holding back from God. And if it's your job or money, you're putting that above God. You need to fix your focus. And we'll get into that. But for now, let's continue on distractions. The devil wants us distracted. The devil loves to try to distract us from God's plan for our lives. Craig Rochelle put it like this. If the devil can't destroy you, he'll distract you. Yeah, I knew. I got the when I read that too. But so distractions can keep us from focusing on what matters. And what Craig Rochelle has totally said is totally true, because you're strong in your faith. You know what God is saying. If the devil says, "Hey, follow me," you're like, "No, I don't want you." If he can't destroy you, he's going to distract you. He'll try putting out traps or try to tempt you into doing something. And if you fall in, you're getting distracted. And we've all done it. I've done it. You guys have done it. Newsflash, I'm not perfect either. But for example, distractions can lead to destruction. Driving. You guys know what rubbernecking is? I only know this because of driver's ed. It's when you're driving and you see an accident. This is something I do and I try not to, but if I see an accident, I don't just go, oh, keep driving. I go. Like while I'm driving, while I'm passing them, don't do that. I try not to, but sometimes it just happens. And that can lead to you getting in an accident. Or another example, if you guys are paranoid about getting pulled over, I've not been pulled over a crazy amount, but if there's a cop behind me, if I see those halogen lights, I start sweating. Even though I'm going 55, I go from one hand on the wheel to 10 and 2 real quick, and I feel like I'm driving worse than I was before. Every time. And I don't know why, because I'm like, I don't have anything in my car, obviously. I mean, I don't have like anything bad. Like, it just happens. So, but I'm getting distracted by what's behind me, and I might rear end someone in front of me. Texting and driving, that's a bad one. No, don't do that. But people do it. I know, like, when I'm driving, like, I'm going to save a city, but it happens around here too. You see someone at a stoplight, they take off with their hands off the wheel. That is dangerous right there. Like, no one should do that, but it can lead to destruction. So distraction in your life can lead to destruction physically, emotionally, and spiritually. Because if you fall into one of a temptation with the devil and it distracts you from what God has for you, it will damage you spiritually. Does that mean you can't be fixed? No, God has forgiveness and God's way more powerful than the devil. The devil has no power compared to God. So let's go ahead and look at Luke 10, 38 through 42 at the home of Martha and Mary. Hopefully this doesn't like squeal when I turn around. All right, so as Jesus and his disciples were on their way, he came to a village where a woman named Martha opened her home to him. She had a sister called Mary who sat at the Lord's feet listening to what he said. But Martha was distracted, keyword, distracted, by all the preparations that had to be made. She came to him and asked, "Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to do the work by myself? Tell her to help." Jesus goes, "Martha, Martha," the Lord answered, "you are worried and upset about many things, but few things are needed, or indeed only one. Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken away from her." And for the people in the back that didn't catch that, I even made it bigger and I highlighted the part where you can go, "Amen," or "Mm-hmm," like, because that's good. "Martha, Martha," the Lord answered, "you are worried and upset about many things, but few things are needed." We have a lot of worries in life. A lot of things are upsetting. And we naturally stress out. We're distracted by things. You know what matters in the end? God. Martha had the Son of God in her home, Jesus. And she was over there scrubbing the floors. If anything, she should be scrubbing his feet and washing them and listening to him. I like the laugh. But that's what he said. But few things are needed, or indeed only one. That leads me to my next point. Worries crowd out worship. Now, ironically, I found out I was preaching on this last Wednesday. On Wednesday this week, I planned the sermon 2 months ago. And it was about Martha and Mary at the home of Martha. So I'm like, wow, God is good. I got double prep in 1 week. Look at that. All right, let's go ahead, and I'm getting ahead of myself. All right, so let's move on to Matthew 14, 22 through 30. Immediately he made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead to the other side. While he dismissed the crowds, and after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up to the mountain by himself to pray. This is Jesus. He went up to pray. When evening came, he was there alone, but by this time, the boat, battered by the waves, was far from the land, for the wind was against them. So, in my mind, a storm's happening right now. Jesus was on the mountain praying, and Peter and his brothers are in the boat. They were fishing like, I mean, I don't know if they were, but by this time the boat, battered by the waves, was far from the land, for the wind was against them. And early in the morning, he came walking towards them on the lake, on the water. I'm telling you, if I saw someone on the walking on the water, I'd run the other way. I'd be so scared. All right, let's see. Oh, but when the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified, saying, "It's a ghost," not Casper. And they cried out in fear, but immediately Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I, do not be afraid." Now we get to the really cool part. Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you out on the water." He said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat, started walking on the water, and came towards Jesus. But when he noticed a strong wind, he became frightened, and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." He got distracted. He had his eyes fixed on Jesus, but he got distracted by the storm. He saw the wind. Maybe there was thunder and lightning. The waves were going hard. He got distracted, and his focus went from here to here, and he began to doubt God, and then he began to sink. So let's go ahead and modernize it. What will my friends think of me? What will my family think of me? What will my coworkers think of me? Those are distractions that keep us from following what God has for us. There's so many more, but those are three really big ones that are just relevant to today's culture. So, like I said, distractions can lead to doubt. Let me go right here. Oh, okay, so what has your attention? Before I forget, yes, I put this picture because it reminded me of me. If I had a dollar for every time I got distracted, I wish I had a puppy. I read it just like that, and that's something I would do or say. So what can be a distraction in your life? What has your attention? Your past can be a distraction. Did you know that God can use you where you're at right now? Whether you just started your walk with God or you've been with him for 30 years, he can use you where you're at right now. If you've surrendered your life to him, you don't have to be perfect. None of us are perfect. But God forgives us. He gives us a fresh start, a clean slate. If you've given your life to God and live for him, he will work wonders through you where you're at right now, no matter what age you are, no matter where you're at in your walk with him. Stop holding what you've done against you and truly give it to God. And if you're on the other side of the spectrum where you've been raised in church, you've had a pretty good life, make sure you aren't comparing yourself to others. Their story is way cooler than mine. They have God has used them way more. God loves you just as much as the next guy or next lady. Stop looking in the rearview mirror and look through the windshield before you get in a wreck. There's no police car behind you. Calm down. 2020 can be a distraction. Yep. Yeah, it can. I should have heard a lot more amens right there, but I'd say that was pretty good. 2020 can be a distraction. It can distract us from following God's plan. The biggest thing I've noticed, it can distract us from loving others. Where's that? Oh, it's down there. Caleb, hold up that mask. Whether someone wears one or someone doesn't, you're still called to love them, regardless. Let's say, no matter what side you're on, God, that doesn't say, love one another. The Bible doesn't say, love your neighbor as yourself, unless they disagree with you. It doesn't say that. You need to love your neighbor regardless. Maybe someone's having a Christmas gathering. You still got to love them, whether you agree with them or not. 2020 can be a distraction because I've seen so many people, and I've probably even done it at times on accident, but they put their opinion above loving others. But we're called to love others. So 2020 can be a distraction. The election can be a distraction. I almost tried skipping it. Yeah, we're in church. Oof. I have political opinions, but regardless of who my neighbor supports, I am called to love them. No matter what sign they have in their yard, Jesus died for their sins, just like he died for yours. If we put that above loving others, we're distracted and we need to readdress our priorities. Social media can be a distraction. I'll wait for it. I don't think I'm a millennial. I think I'm Gen Z or something. It don't matter. You could be my grandpa. He's on Facebook. I mean, he's really on it, but he's usually playing games on his phone or something. Social media is not a big deal to him, but whatever that game is he plays on his phone, I forgot it. I'll ask him later and I'll tell you guys if you want. But social media, that speaks for itself. But who really only spends 30 seconds on Twitter? This is a real story that I'm about to tell you guys that happened last week. When I was preparing for this message, I'm a pretty distracted person, but I didn't realize just how distracted I get. I'm going to read my Bible, and I saw someone tag me in a post. Just as I'm about to open my Bible reading plan, someone tagged me in the post, so I hit their name. I'll go right back to reading my Bible. It should only take 10 seconds. Like it, comment. I like, comment. Next thing you know, I'm on Facebook for 30 minutes. I'm looking at everyone's posts. Wait a minute, I was supposed to read my Bible. Social media can be a distraction. From that day on, I've been just using my Bible because my Bible doesn't have notification banners on it. But I didn't realize that, and it makes me wonder, how many times did I not realize I was doing that? If you're watching online right now, let's say you're watching on a phone, I guarantee you've had notification banners pop up. If you haven't clicked on them, you've got some self-control. I'll be honest, last week, I even did it. Sorry, Pastor Len, I know you're watching in there. I came right back, I promise. Your job can be a distraction. If you're putting your job above God, or your family even, it's a distraction. You obviously need a job, but if you put it above God, you need to fix your focus. We'll get into that, fixing your focus in a little bit. Money is a big distraction. Money is a really good thing to have if you use it the right way. But if you put it above God, you need to fix your focus. I've heard people say, money is the root of all evil. The love of money is the root of all evil. 1 Timothy 6, and that's true. And money can be used for a lot of good, but as soon as we put it above God, it's a distraction. I was just researching some things on distraction, how it works, how many times a day you're distracted. I think my number is a lot higher than the daily average. But I came across this article written by the Harvard Business Review about Disney World. I know some people in here really like Disney World. A few years ago, Disney World executives were wondering what most captured the attention of toddlers and infants at their theme park and hotels in Orlando. So they hired me, not me, the guy who wrote this. It'd be cool if they hired me, though. And a cultural anthropologist to observe them as they passed by all the costume cast members, animated creatures, twirling rides, sweet-smelling snacks, and colorful toys. But after a couple of hours of close observation, we realized what most captured the attention of young children wasn't Disney's conjured magic. It was their parents' cell phones. I went to Disney for the first time last year. I didn't look at their phone one time. I was obsessed with those rides. It was fun. They got live giraffes and like animals. It's really cool. But that's the thing that kids wanted most. This right here can be used for good. There's a Bible on here, but it can be used for a lot of bad too. It can distract you. And you know I'm being serious because I'm a young person that has social media. I get distracted by it. I looked at my screen time because I mentioned that somewhere coming up here soon. It's gone down 2 hours a day, which is good since I started preparing for this because I realized how easily I get distracted. But those kids clearly understood what held their parents' attention, and they wanted it too. Cell phones were enticing action centers of their worlds as they observed it. When parents were using their phones, they were not paying complete attention to their children. Giving undivided attention is the first and most basic ingredient in any relationship, including with God. It is impossible to communicate, much less bond, with someone who can't or won't focus on you. At the same time, we often fail to realize how what we focus on comes to control our thoughts, our actions, and indeed our very lives. That's big. Because if God isn't what you're focused on, something else is controlling your thoughts, action, and life. And if we're being true Christians, surrendered to God, He should be our primary focus. Nothing should be above Him. Is your focus on God? Is He what consumes your thoughts and actions, your life? We need to fix our eyes on Him and to fix our focus on Him. So let's go ahead and look at fixing our focus. Deuteronomy 11, these are just verses. Whoops, did this cut out? No. They're verses in Deuteronomy 11. They're kind of scrambled throughout. But love the Lord your God and keep His requirements, His decrees, His laws, and His commands always. Love the Lord your God and serve Him with all your heart and with all your soul. Be careful or you will be enticed to turn away and worship other gods and bow down to them. Fix these words of mine in your hearts and minds. Teach them to your children, talking about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Carefully observe all these commands I am giving you to follow, to love the Lord your God, to walk in obedience to Him, and to hold fast to Him. See, I am setting before you today a blessing and a curse. The blessing, if you obey the commands of the Lord your God that I am giving you today. The curse, if you disobey the commands of the Lord your God and turn from the way that I command you to today by following other gods. And I'm relevant to today. We're not talking like Greek gods or anything. We're talking things we put above God. Idols. That phone can be an idol. I've heard it put like this, especially working with teens. Ball is life. Basketball is life. Weightlifting is life. It's not bad. But it's what you, it's like what this says. We often fail to realize what we focus on comes to control our thoughts, actions, and lives. If we're focused on basketball, you better believe you're going to get pretty good at basketball if you put in the effort. But if our focus is on God, you're going to become a strong Christian. You're going to be able to share the word of God with others and share the love of God and walk in the love of Christ. So God commands His people to keep their focus fixed on Him. Fix these words of mine in your hearts and minds. Another translation says, commit yourselves wholeheartedly to these words of mine. Is the focus of your heart and mind fixed on God? Do you seek His will in prayer? Notice I didn't ask if you just pray. Do you seek His will? Are we putting His will above ours? Because if not, odds are you're distracted. God wants to give you the desires of His heart, but He also wants you to follow His will. So we need to put His will above ours. Do you seek His will in the Word of God? When you read your Bible, are you just reading words on a page? Is it going into your soul, and are you living it out? Are you sharing it with others? Are you studying it? Are you praying about it? I used to just open my Bible and just read, and I'd read, and I'm a pretty fast reader, but I can't remember half of it. In school, when they did those tests, like they'd time your reading, I was always like, ooh, I got this. I'd read really fast. Now tell me what it was about. I don't know. I wouldn't know half the time because I would just be so focused on just reading fast. I wasn't focusing on what it actually said. You can do that with your Bible pretty easily. So when I read my Bible, I pray for God to limit distractions, none, and to help me realize, like, that He would just speak to me through His Word. And if I don't understand something, I highlight it. I have a lot of highlights in my Bible. I'm sure we all would. But do you express your love for Him in the way you are obedient to His requirements, decrees, laws, and commands? And let's go ahead here. We may fall short. We all fall short in the glory of God. If we are honest, all of us fall short, but that does not mean we should not try to be like God, to try to keep his commands, his decrees and laws, and just walk in his love. Failing is part of it. We just got to get back up and ask for forgiveness. Listen to the advice of Proverbs 4, 24 through 27. Keep your mouth free of perversity. Keep corrupt talk far from your lips. Let your eyes look straight ahead. Fix your gaze directly before you. He's telling you to focus on him. Give careful thought to the paths for your feet and be steadfast in all your ways. Do not turn to the right or left. Keep your foot from evil. Don't turn from right or left. Squirrel, don't do that. The devil's going to try to throw temptation your way. Stay focused. The devil tried tempting Jesus. He definitely won. Jesus won. The devil couldn't do anything. The devil eventually just left, and he's like, okay, I give up. Tap out. Where are we at? Okay. Those are wise words, true words. We must walk in a different direction from many in this world. Not everyone in this world is a Christian. Just because you go to church, it doesn't make you a Christian any more than going in the garage makes you a car. You got to live it. Or going in the chicken coop makes you a chicken. I like that one. But you have to live for God. You have to surrender to him. And you have to, like I said, live for him. We are commanded to walk the right path, to fix our gaze on following God's ways. Not sidetracked by the distractions of the world, we must stand firm in our faith. Instead of wandering onto the broad way of destruction, we must follow the narrow way, the pathway to heaven. Yeah, we can get distracted, and if we do get distracted, just ask God to fix your focus. I don't want to say it's that simple, because it's going to take effort, but it's worth it. 2 Corinthians 4:18 says, "So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal." This is a reminder to dare to keep looking through the eyes of faith to God, to dare to focus on the things of heaven. The things of this world will pass, but the eternal things of God will never fade or pass away. We must fix our focus on God. As the worship team comes up, I want to leave you guys with a question. Well, four questions. What are you focusing on? What has priority in your life? Where are you headed? What are you living for? What is your life revolving around? What do you need to do to make God your focus? Some of us here, maybe we thought we were once headed down the right path, but we got distracted. We fell into temptation. Talk to someone you can trust about it. And that will be honest with you, a Christian, obviously, that will give you wise counsel. And just turn back to God. Just for here. The devil likes to try to drag away your focus from God. Well, just for here, right back over to him. You follow God's plan for your life and do that by fixing your focus on him. So I'm going to go ahead and pray. Dear God, I pray that we would fix our eyes on you. I pray that we would just limit the distractions in our lives. That we wouldn't just come to church and not share it. We'd share it and then we'd live it. So the distractions are in our lives. The devil's afraid to distract us, God. I want us to follow you and focus on you so much that the devil feels like he can't touch us. I pray that you would just be with us this season, and health and safety for everyone, and that you would just have your way. In your name I pray, amen.
Over the skies of Beth Ham appeared a star, while angels to say the lowly shepherd. Three wise men seeking truth traveled from afar, hoping to find a child from heaven, falling on their knees, bowed before the Prince of Peace. I bring an offering of worship to my King. No one on earth deserves the praises that I sing. Jesus, may you receive the honor that you're due. Oh Lord, I bring an offering. Sun cannot compare to the glory of your love. There is no shadow in your presence. No mortal man would dare stand before your throne, before the Holy One of heaven. It's only by your
thank you. the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who'd come to the Father are restored, and the church of Christ was born. Then the Spirit lit the flame, and the sky of truth above shall not kneel and shall not fade. By His blood and in His name, in His freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me.
God, I pray that we would just live out your word, God. That we would just limit the distractions in our lives, and that we would just focus on you. I pray for everyone here and out there, out in the world, God, for just a safe and fun holiday season for Christmas and the new year. I pray that you would just provide safety and health, and that we would just enjoy this time, even of 2020, that we would just not let it be a distraction. That we would fix our eyes on the true meaning of Christmas. And that we would worship you as families, as individuals. In your name I pray. Amen. There are Christmas Eve kits in the back because we're going to have an online service. We're right there. Feel free to take one. If you have a bigger family and need more things, go ahead, let us know, and we will get more things for you. You guys are dismissed. Merry Christmas.
Set the captives.